For much of the past year, Björk has been living in southern Spain, where she recorded her third solo album.
I think there's something very special about living at the edges of continents, and it just feels completely different. And it shouldn't, you know, that you look out the window and you can see another continent over there. And it's just kind of like, it's a really healthy turn on somehow. The idea that every morning you could wake up and literally go to Africa. When I lived by the ocean there, I used to wake up every morning and have to walk for like an hour and like cross. And then I felt like I was in Spain. And then I could work. And I wake up the morning after and I still hadn't just grasped the idea. So I had to do that for a month. And then I moved up here to the mountain. And the only way I can take all this in, because it's just so outrageous, and I keep just thinking of Mum, just looking at her back, it's just like, they're gonna pull the curtains in a sec. These are the things that I own, that I usually have in my house, where I do all the demos. So we set this up and brought this down to Spain. When I did debut and post, they were very much like greatest hits of my musical passions for all my life. And I knew it would take two albums to do that. That's why I called them debut and post, before and after, of getting rid of the back catalogue almost, you know, gracefully, you know, because you can only move on if you do that, you know. So this is like a fresh start for me. And that's why I want to call this album Homogenic or Genus or Genius or whatever. I'm still working on that because it's one flavour. It's just me now, you know, here. And it's going to be, instead of like all these different instruments, it's just going to be beats, strings and voice. Einhvern tímann myndavélina fara í taugarnar á okkur, þá látið mig vita, af því þetta nummer eitt. Já. I knew that this album would be like back to Iceland, sort of what I'm about. But it's very hard to kind of start from complete scratch with no tradition whatsoever. But there were some pioneers who were trying to look at the landscape and the country and try to change that, what they saw and what they felt, into audio.
There are certain Icelandic composers, and when they compose Icelandic music, they, you know, try to imitate geysers or volcanoes, because the landscape in Iceland is very rough. It's, you know, we don't have like this, you know, trees. We don't barely have any trees. We have a lot of lavas, we have a lot of volcanoes, and there's a lot of outburst of, you know, weather, suddenly the wind comes or snowstorms. And that kind of sounds, I think she's looking after, and she's talked about that. She wants more of this raw sound, not this beautiful European sound, maybe.
To find that voice is very challenging, you know, and it's almost like you have to invent your own roots. And that's one of the reasons why I got the 8 string players. I wanted them all to be Icelandic.
Það þarf ekki að fara bara vibrato og...
Ok, ok.
Meira mátt.
Ok,
ok.
Og bara, þú veist, ossalega, þú veist, hvað Mata Hari. Þetta er þannig lag, sko.
Það er alveg rétt.
Svo næstu því of, eða skilur við?
Já.
Málu verið að þú svolítið svona...
Já, já.
Yfir.
Ok.
Well, I picked up some her uses of intervals, for instance, fifths, and that's very traditional in Iceland and actually very unique. Icelandic folk songs often use this interval of fifths throughout, you know, the whole song. And that, and she uses that in her pieces, that makes it very Icelandic. For instance, in The Hunter, the two cellos, they are playing two-bar motif. And, you know, one of them plays the lower note, then the other cellist plays it a fifth above. And there, when you hear that, that's just right away, you know, that's Icelandic.
I wrote a song called Hunter, And it's based on what my grandmother told me on Christmas about two different types of birds who are birds that always have the same nest all their lives, like swans, and they always have the same partners all life. And they're birds that travel all the time and they always have different partners all the time. And kind of like to make a conscious decision to stay a hunter. It kind of ended up being a little bit of a bolero, I guess. Maybe because it's Spain. That's the only song with a string arrangement I asked Deodato to do completely.
One of the notes that we had, we discussed maybe trying a figure such as a bolero, you know, Ravel's bolero. In the course of the recording, we decided to exaggerate certain aspects of the string parts by having the strings doing sliding notes and kind of sluggish and slurring. When she sends me something, it's pretty much done. What I understand and I was correct in understanding it that way is that she really wants a color. She really wants the humanizing factor into tracks that are basically, how do you say, sequenced using different sounds or using electronic sounds.
It's good also if we put one take down and have that as well. Mm-hmm. We come tomorrow and we can listen to it. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And then we know what to fix,
absolutely,
if that works or not. But at least we put it down.
Okay. Right. That's a different machine, but same size. And you have 8 tracks and 100 noises. And you can make as many songs as you want. And a lot of my tunes for the last 4 years I wrote on that. It's so incredibly convenient. Mm-hmm. Put the batteries in and you can take it. You can write on the airplane or your grand's house on the top of a volcano or in a club or in a tube. And but this is different machine, this is like a sampler. Mark Bell bought this one and he's just teaching me it.
It's just a way of capturing like noises, like say acoustic instruments or, you know, other noises, but then being able to change the pitch of them, you know, like to make them, you know, any noise into like music then, like could be a door shutting for a drum sound.
What I'd love to do live is kind of put a lot of effects on my voice. Obsessed with electricity. My dad's an electrician, and my grandfather too. And I've been obsessed since I was a kid with people like Stockhausen, Kraftwerk, Brian Eno. Electricity has always existed, and it's not just a phenomenon of this century. And it's always been in thunder and lightnings, and in Iceland the Thor's hammer, you know. And an acupuncture has been around for 1 or 2,000 years. Electricity and equipment are just tools. instead of wood or leather or metal and all these things that we so far made music out of, stroking a string, we're using electricity and to make for the ear. For me, that is probably what I would call techno.
Deny me of something while I've got plenty. You're the one who's missing out, but you won't notice until after 5 years. If you live that long, you'll wake up all loveless. I dare you to take me on. I dare you to show me your pals. I'm so bored of cowards that say they want, then they can't endure.
There is like a purpose behind it, where the drums are really hard and then the voice beautiful. It's just like the contrast. For something to be beautiful, something's got to be, you know, ugly. If everything's beautiful, then, you know, nothing's beautiful.
You can't handle love, baby. You can't handle love. Oh, it's obvious. You can't handle. I dare you. I dare you. I dare you.
When you first meet an Icelander, sometimes they are cold. But then, when they warm up to you, they are very fiery. We are very fiery people.
My cards, you deal me another hand. Even when I sleep, you're real. On your way to me, you don't have to speak.
Most of my work I do in my head, just when I'm doing other things. And I don't know if it's because I've been doing it for long or because I spent so many years without recording my songs. I wasn't until 27 I started recording them. That I naturally become quite organized in my head, and I got all these different sections and little cupboards and drawers. And I start that idea and I put it in a drawer, and I can come back to it a year later and it will still be there. So I walk in a room and it looks like I'm starting a song, but it's actually, in a way, I've maybe been working on it for a year.
Var þetta ekki miklu betra?
Miklu, já. Getum farið ennþá lengur.
Ok.
Í alveg, þetta er alveg bara svona sound of music.
Já, ok.
Þú veist, alveg, þú veist, alveg bara
svona
væn. I write about one song a month. And it's usually just the theme of that month, like the soundtrack to that month in my life. This is the lyric to a song about my best mate, Yoga. But all the other pages, there's absolutely no way I'll open for you, whatever you offer me, because that's so private, it's scary. And I've got a beautiful secret code, which is called Icelandic. So you guys will never find out what says in this.
You see what's inside of me. Every nerve that hurts, you heal deep inside of me. Ooh, you don't have to speak, I feel.
Number 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, and all the way up to 73. I'm a pop musician, and I'm making music for everyone, not for VIP or educated people or something like that. So I want to make that. It has to be pop music, you know, that everybody can relate to, and so it's a challenge, it's an experiment, and I haven't got a clue we'll work on it, but you have to try.